Okay, welcome everyone to the 2011 Bowie lecture. My name is Dave Sandel. I'm currently the president of the geodesy section. The Bowie lecture is an annual event sponsored by the geodesy section. And each year we find a distinguished scientist to talk about highlights in their field of geodesy. And we try to rotate through the different fields of geodesy each year. This year, it's my pleasure to introduce Kosuke Heki as our Bowie lecturer. Kosuke received his PhD in 1984 from University of Tokyo with a thesis entitled Paleomagnetic Study of the Central Andes with Special Reference to Bolivian Orocline. Currently, he's a professor at Hokkaido University, where he teaches classes in geodesy and geophysics. His research is focused in many areas, including VLBI, campaign GPS, gravity field of the moon, crustal deformation from snow loading, looking at dense GPS arrays, which we'll probably hear about, megathrust earthquakes, time variations in gravity with GRACE, and effects of earthquake waves on the ionosphere, which I think we'll hear about today. Basically, he's worked in almost all these areas of satellite geodesy. So the title of his presentation is GPS Array as a Sensor of Lithosphere, Troposphere, and Ionosphere.
Thank you very much. I'm very glad to be able to give a talk to so many people. I hope everybody enjoys my talk until the end. So let's start. So this building is a symbol of my university, an old clock tower. And I will show you the real picture. Okay. So my talk is about a dense GPS array. And nowadays, they exist all over the world. For example, here in the United States, they have PBO. And in active countries like Iceland and Taiwan and New Zealand, and even in Sumatra and Malaysia, and in South America. And now I'm talking mainly on the Japanese network called GeoNet. So GPS can be used in various purposes. And I pick up three of those. And first, I talk about crustal movement. And second, water vapor measurement. And third, about total reactant content. And I will spend about a quarter for the first two and about a half for the third topic. So this is how it started in 1994 with about 100 stations and additional 100 stations in Kanto Tokai area. And it became like this in next year. And the next year, now we have this. So the major mushrooming occurred in the first year. So something happened in the first year of GeoNet. And this is a picture of the co-seismic crustal movement associated with 1994 Hokkaido earthquake. And we could see this kind of picture only a few days after the earthquake. So everybody thought GPS is great. So that is why it expanded. And so this is the earthquake I was talking about. And 2 months later, there's another earthquake. And this is eastward movement of that station. And at this time, we could for the first time see the major aftersleep following the main shock. So this is what a seismometer cannot see. So this is a picture appeared in a newspaper. And the third earthquake, this is January of 1995. So this is not a big earthquake, but there are many casualties. So these earthquakes proved the usefulness of GeoNet. And the largest earthquake occurred this year, early. And these are the pictures I took myself. And here you can see that the length of the arrow is proportional to the log. So now you can see that the whole country deformed in this earthquake, even in the southernmost part. And nowadays, we also have some seafloor GPS points. And this is post-seismic movement in the first 10 days, I guess. And this is a pre-seismic movement. It's over the 3 days period before the earthquake. So this is actually the mixture of the co-seismic movement of the magnitude 7.3 foreshock. And it's very fast after sleep. So everybody will be interested in if we could see the things like this. So this is the most famous earthquake precursor considered to be recorded before the 1944 Tōnankai earthquake by the Leveling Survey over the few hours before the earthquake. And I will show you several interesting pictures. These are the eastward movement of three stations along the Fukushima coast. And you can see that the first 10 years and the last 5 years look very different. And I will close up the bottom figure. By microscopic view, these steps are by the several magnitude 7 earthquakes, and they have very big aftersleeps. So we thought we understand what is going on, but if we look at from the distance, this is a co-seismic movement. This looks like something related to the earthquake, but the first 10 years is not long enough to consider with confidence that this is abnormal. So this is a very interesting figure to see. And if you are interested, there's a parallel session over there. So you could catch at least the second one. And this is something more peaceful. A slow sleep event in the southernmost part of Japan. Here, the convergence rate is very fast. It's more than 10 centimeters per year. And look at the movement of this station from the beginning of this year. So this is a trenchwide movement. Occurs twice this year. So this is a biannually repeating slow sleep event. And over the last 15 years, we had similar slow sleep events. It's 28 times occurred every half year. And it is very likely that next one will occur at the end of the next March. So a certain team is waiting for the next one. They deployed two AGs and one SG in one of these islands, and it's another AG. So they are trying to see the movement of the fluid at depths associated with the occurrence of the slow sleep event. And I do hope they find something interesting in the next March. Although it is biannual, if I compare the occurrence months, it is quite random, but its interval has a strong peak. So this is not a seasonal occurrence. But there are many things seasonal, really seasonal in Japan. I will show one of those. This is a baseline, only 100 kilometers in length, but it experiences 1 centimeter peak-to-peak seasonal change, and it is shorter during the winter and longer in summer. And I wrote a paper saying that this is due to the load by the snow. And some people believed and other people did not. And now I have independent evidence from GRACE. So I will show the difference between summer and winter. So this is the February gravity relative to August. This is an average of the about 6 years. And these signatures are the in the high latitude regions are the gravitational pull of the snow. And you can see in the northern half of Japan, small red signature. So this is snow. And this is equivalent to about 74 gigatons or about 74 cubic kilometers, a huge amount. So this is why even in a dry summer, we do not experience shortage of water so often. But the things are different in southwestern Japan. Okay, so now I move from lithosphere to atmosphere. Okay, so this is the concept of the ground-based GPS meteorology. Because the thickness of the atmosphere is dependent on the elevation angle, we can estimate the zenith total delay as an independent parameter together with the station coordinates. And this total delay is composed of hydrostatic delay, which can be calculated from the surface pressure. So you can isolate the water vapor. And this is very useful information for weather forecast. And Japan is one of the few countries actually using the GPS-derived water vapor information in the actual weather forecast mesoscale model since 2 years ago. So by incorporating the GPS information, there's a significant improvement in the forecast accuracy. And I don't talk much about meteorological stuff, but something with a longer time span from GPS meteorology to climatology. So this is the 15 days in summer at this station, the northernmost GPS point. And if it is 1 year, you can see the seasonal change. In summer, there are more water vapor because it is warmer. And now it is 5 years. And if it is 13 years, you are starting to see something climatological. For example, this is a station in central Tokyo and one in southern Japan. And I model the time scale, time series with a seasonal plus cubic polynomial. And these smooth curves are those without a seasonal change. And I try to compress this. Now you can see something. So this degree three change, this is possibly reflecting decadal climate change known as Pacific decadal oscillation. So this is one of the climate signal in GeoNet water vapor. And also, you can see the ENSO signatures. El Nino brings a mild winter in southern Japan and opposite in La Nina winters. And this is a time series of the SST off the Peru coast. So this is a kind of ENSO index. So I will take out two winters. This is La Nina winter, and second, this is El Nino winter. And compare the residual from the standard seasonal curve. So you can see that this winter is colder than this winter. And it is mainly influencing the southern half of Japan. And even we can see the solid earth signal in GPS meteorology data. For example, this is geoid, and there's a geoid low along the Japan coast and making the slope of the rather steep slope of geoid relative to the reference ellipsoid. especially it is the case in the Kanto district. And atmosphere is stratified in parallel with the geoid, of course, but we calculate the elevation angle relative to reference ellipsoid. So this causes a kind of apparent atmospheric delay gradient. And this is expected gradient. It is not more than 0.5 millimeter, but this is large enough for us to see. For example, this is a time averaged gradient. This is supposed to be tending south, but there is some clockwise deflection in the Kanto area. So I think this is coming from geoid slope in Japan. So I have finished talking about maybe a bit too quick. I will speak slowly from now. And now I'm going up to the ionosphere. And I prepared two different topics. So this is how we measure the ionospheric electrons with GPS by comparing the phases of the two microwaves with different wavelengths. It is the difference is proportional to the number of electrons along the line of sight. And that is what we call total electron content. And let me call this just tech. And ultraviolet flux from the sun ionize the neutral molecule in the upper atmosphere and making electrons. But if something special comes in, for example, the water vapor molecule, there's a special, very complicated reaction between the ions and molecules, and depletion of electron occurs. So this means, for example, we could count how many comets are coming into the Earth's atmosphere using GPS array. And I have read this paper many, many years ago, and I had this on my mind. And however, it is not only the comet that brings water vapor into the upper atmosphere. It's also rockets. And I want to explain one term. When you draw the line of sight, and the electron is the densest at around 300 kilometers from the ground, and the intersection is called ionospheric piercing point, and it's their ground projections, I call them sub-ionospheric point. And I will show you some figures showing the anomaly in the tech by plotting these sub-ionospheric points on the map. So this is a map taken at some time in the April 2009. And green means everything is normal. And red means the more electron. And blue means less electron. So you can see some linear anomaly, negative anomaly here. So something has flown from west to east. And these are 9 snapshots, starting here and starting with the linear anomaly and expanding and making a fairly large ionospheric hole in only 20 minutes. And this is a story about this. They launch something, and the first stage fell into the Sea of Japan, and the second stage flew above the Japanese island and crashed to the Pacific Ocean. And there's a debate about what this was. So they say this is the launch of a satellite. And we think it could be a test of a ballistic missile. Nobody knows. So I'm not a patriot, but I and one of my students wanted to do something like a challenge with GeoNet. How far we can, with a GPS array, can know anything about this flying object. So this is the first stage, and it didn't reach the ionosphere. And it's a second stage, actually made a hole in the ionosphere. So I did a kind of simulation in the computer. And the left column shows the water density. So this curve is the trajectory. So it diffuses from the trajectory. And it is a kind of anisotropic diffusion. So diffusion is faster upward and slower downward. And this is an equation. The changing rate of the electron density is composed of three terms. The first is a natural decay, and second is a natural generation of the new electrons, and third term is anthropogenic decay. This is proportional to the density of the water molecule. So the right-hand column is formation and development of the ionospheric hole around the trajectory, starting from the 6 minutes after the launch to the 20 minutes after the launch. And I compare with observed GPS data. So the left-hand side is the synthesized one, and right-hand side is observed one at the same apex. So you can see that these two are very similar. So we thought we could understand what happened. And this is a time series of the a few stations here to see the SIP directly beneath the trajectory. So this is a drop by the formation of ionospheric hole. And dashed curves are the synthesized results. So you can see they are very consistent. And I could constrain the thrust power by measuring the number of water molecules included in the exhaust gas of the rocket. And the same thing occurred also in 1998, 11 years before the second one. And here, the formation of the ionospheric hole is much weaker, so the hole is smaller. So this means the thrust power is about 1 to 6. So we wrote a paper in JGR, but this didn't draw much attention of geodesists, but draw some attention of some kind of people. I got many telephone calls from people working in public security agency or self-defense force and even South Korean embassy. So let's get back to the earth science. I'm talking about co-seismic disturbance of ionosphere and something that happened before the earthquake. And it is known that earthquake folding makes several different kinds of atmospheric waves, like internal gravity waves and acoustic wave. And it makes the irregularities in the ionosphere, and we can measure them by GPS. It is just like a seismic wave. For example, a surface wave goes around the Earth several times, and body waves penetrate the Earth. But it also goes upward, reaching the space. So I will show several examples of six different earthquakes using the common horizontal axis showing the hour from the earthquakes. And you can see that it starts about 10 minutes after the earthquake. So this is the time required for the acoustic wave to propagate from the ground to the F layer. And you can even tell the mechanism of the earthquake. In Japan, so there, most of the earthquakes have the thrust or reverse folding mechanisms. So in that case, it starts with a positive pulse. And this is one of the exception. This is a magnitude 8 authorized earthquake with normal fault mechanisms. So you can see the reverse change, initial change. So this can be used to constrain the mechanism of the earthquakes. And for very large earthquakes, resonance between the atmosphere and the ground continues for several hours. So this is because 4.5 minutes, this is the frequency of the atmospheric mode. So there's a resonant oscillation occurring in the atmosphere. So after the Tohoku-Oki earthquake this year, they could find something like this. So this is already published. So there are several different groups are working on this, and these are the pictures drawn by a Japanese group, and they have a poster on Friday. So they could show a very beautiful circular wave, and these are made by the internal gravity wave. And in order to study the co-seismic disturbances, we normally apply a high pass filter. But if we do not use the high pass filter, the low tech time series looks like this, because the GPS receiver moves in the sky and its penetration length changes in time. So this is a typical apparent change. And if there are more electrons, the curvature becomes stronger, like this. And what I'm going to show today is a newly found signature. So this is the time, and this is the tech, and this is the arrival of the acoustic wave. And there's something like a slow increase toward the earthquake. So this is one of the examples with satellite 15. It's very close to the zenith, and these smooth curves are the modeled apparent change. And I define the departure from this model curve as the anomaly, and the positive anomaly starts about 1 hour before the earthquake and lasts until the arrival of the acoustic wave. So this is also observed by other satellites. For example, and I show you the geographical distribution at three epochs. I mean, 1 hour before the earthquake, and 20 minutes before, and 1 minute before. So this is approximate fault, and this is the epicenter. And nothing abnormal 1 hour before, and this region somehow becomes start to increase. And this is another satellite. So this satellite is sinking in the eastern sky. So the apparent change looks very different from the previous one. But you can see the similar signature starting about 1 hour before the earthquake. And again, I show you the distribution of the anomaly 1 hour before, 20 minutes before, and 1 minute before. So, And also we could see the negative anomaly surrounding the positive one. But we cannot see the exact distribution in the two-dimensional space because the distribution of the GPS station is limited. So I don't know if this is a precursor or a part of the earthquake. I don't know, but I thought I found something very important and interesting and published a paper in GRL and got many, many questions, of course. And these questions are classified into four categories. If this is not an artifact coming from the co-seismic ion depletion, and how about in other earthquakes? And take enhancement by other solar terrestrial origins and the mechanism. So they are all very good questions, and I will answer each of those. So the answer is, this is the real one. I'm the first person who asked this question, of course, to myself. So this is a picture I draw about 1 week after the earthquake. To make a model, I assumed that the vertical tech obeys the cubic polynomial of time, and in estimating this coefficient, I excluded the influenced part. But if you think another part is abnormal, you can model in a different way. Then the anomaly will disappear. So artifact hypothesis is saying that this is caused by, this is a secondary phenomena or an artifact caused by the co-seismic drop. So this is a very good point. And there are two kind of objections I will show you here. With another satellite, I will show you that the anomaly is fixed to the space. And second, I can show you that I can identify numerically the onset of the anomaly. This is satellite 9. This appears in the southern sky and moves towards north. And here, the anomaly appears very close to the fault, and it stays here, not going with the GPS stations. And for example, if you take one point in the southernmost part in Hokkaido, there is a relatively large pre-seismic increase but small co-seismic decrease. So this is one of the evidence that this is a real one. And also we can constrain the starting time of the enhancement. Just take out this part and model the observed change with two lines connected with each other. And I just move the elbow back and forth and see the behavior of RMS. And we could see a very clear minimum in the RMS, so which means close to the epicenter, it started about 1 hour before the earthquake, but it become, onset time becomes later as we go apart from the epicenter. And the next question, unfortunately, this earthquake occurred during a geomagnetic storm. So many people asks me if this is caused by solar terrestrial physics, and I cannot rule out that possibility. And the best way to answer is seeing the other large earthquakes. And it occurs for all the earthquakes. And these are the five largest earthquakes that occurred during the last decade. Maule earthquake and Tohoku earthquake and three Sumatran earthquakes. And this is the second largest earthquakes studied by GeoNet. And these two earthquakes are very important, but it is not large enough for this kind of study. So first, this is a Spartan earthquake. So the number of the stations is limited, so it is difficult to see from this figure. But this is a time series of five stations in Malaysia from south to north. And you can see very similar signature, this seismic tectonic enhancement starting about 1 hour before the earthquake. And this is the Chilean case, satellite 17. The southernmost station did not have anything. But these stations show a very similar waveform to the Tohoku earthquake case. And there's another satellite from south to north along the Chilean coast. So you can see the arrival of acoustic wave here. And also you can see that positive anomaly started about 40 minutes in this case before the earthquake. It is very similar signature. And two additional earthquakes in Sumatra. So this is a larger one, occurred in 2005, and this is a smaller one, but still it's magnitude 8.6, depending on the papers. This network, unfortunately, sampling rate is 2 minutes, so data is a little bit different. First, the larger one, unfortunately, is a very strong plasma bubble activity over about 1 or 2 hours before the earthquake and lasting after the earthquake. So I could not see anything for this earthquake. So this is a typical plasma bubble activity. But for the smaller one, Bunker earthquake in 2007, I could see something very similar. This is showing from north to south somehow. And another satellite. And 1 hour before is almost nothing, and positive anomaly exists 20 minutes before and 1 minute before. So it is very similar. And this is a magnitude 8.2 or 3 Hokkaido earthquake in 1994. You could see a positive anomaly to the southern side of the fault starting 20 minutes before. And this is a time series. Now this looks a bit noisier. And it means this is very small. Amplitude is very small. And another satellite. OK, I compiled all the earthquakes. From the largest one is the Sumatra Andaman earthquake. It's a red one. And two satellites showing the Tohoku earthquake this year, and Chilean earthquake last year, and Sumatra Bunker earthquake with brown, and green one is Hokkaido Tohoku earthquake in 1994. So there's a clear dependence on the magnitude of the atmosphere. Now I'm comparing the vertical anomaly just before the earthquake. But it is another problem. It is another issue that if we can recognize this anomaly for a kind of early warning before the earthquake, because it starts very slowly, so it could be very difficult. And another reason why I say this is difficult is there's also various kinds of tech enhancement occurring naturally. For example, by solar flares and traveling disturbances. And this is one of the largest solar flare occurred this year. This is X-class flare occurred February 15th this year. And you can see the sudden increase of tech and lasting about 1 hour. And if you take out just one point, you cannot tell the difference. But it occurs over the entire sunlit hemisphere, like this. So this is rather easy to discriminate. And this is what they call medium-scale traveling ionospheric disturbance, or MSTID. So this is a kind of oscillation moving from north to south. And its wavelength is much shorter. So also, and this occurred on the same day as the earthquake. But this is easy to discriminate. But this is a large-scale TID coming from the aurora oval southward across the Japanese islands. So it is also moving, but its wavelength is very large. So if you take out just a snapshot, it is very difficult to discriminate. It takes some time. So this is a major problem. So the mechanism, I wish I could say I don't know, because I'm not an expert on this kind of issue. I just introduced a recent paper on this topic. Surface charge may have disturbed the ionosphere. This is a very recent paper by a joint Taiwan and American group in JGR, ionospheric plasma bubble and density variation induced by pre-earthquake rock currents and associated surface charges. And what they say is that if they assume this magnitude of the current in rock before the rupture, they say they could influence the tech by up to 20%. So this is their story. If there's a charge here, it makes a vertical electric field and current. And after reaching the ionosphere, it becomes radial outward. And it causes what they call E cross B drift. And E cross B drift is upward in the eastern side and downward on the western side. And this is a picture on the western side. So electron is coming down. So this is a pair, we will see the pair of positive and negative anomaly. So I talked with first author of this paper and just agreed to do some joint work to reproduce what we see before the earthquake. So perhaps to prove this, we need some systematic observation of precise behaviors of our surface electric field. And this is what we do not have yet. So this is the answer to FAQ. So this is a real one, and it occurs before large earthquakes. And it is, as a phenomena, sometimes confusing. And there's one possibility. So if you want to hear more, I have a poster on Friday. And if you want to analyze GPS data yourself, so nothing is secret. Most of the GPS data available online. And a simple program to convert Linux file to text available in my web page. So my last topic about something about the earthquake. So this is, I think this is a very good picture taken after the earthquake. GPS pillar, this is a relatively new one in Natori City in Miyagi Prefecture. This is located in the within the junior high school. So this is surrounded by tsunami debris, but it's still standing. So I want to say the earthquake and tsunami was a disaster. But anyway, it should happen sometimes. So if we could select the time, now we are less unlucky that this earthquake occurred after the deployment of many geophysical sensors, especially the GeoNet. Otherwise, if it occurred 30 years before, then we couldn't learn much like we did now. So I think this is the last one. I just want to say thank you to these people provided data. And some parts are the joint work with my PhD students. It's about 45 minutes. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you for that very interesting and provocative talk. And I'm expecting some questions here. I think this is a completely new area, and I hope people want to speak up and ask some questions that you haven't asked yet, perhaps. If you do have a question, I ask you go to that microphone in the center of the room.
Thanks very much, Dr. Heki. This is Attila Komjati from JPL. You mentioned you cannot rule out the possibility that the Tohoku earthquake may have been caused by geomagnetic or activity or any kind of space weather anomaly. We looked at all four of your events that you presented in the GRL paper, and three out of the four were associated with geomagnetic disturbance. So I'd just like to point out it's a very strong possibility that these pre-seismic enhancements may have been caused by space weather effects. And also, we looked at other parts of the globe. So we have looked at the global network of GPS receivers, and we found very similar signatures prior to the earthquake. And they look exactly just the same as they were presented in your presentation. So I'd like to invite you to our poster where we presented the evidence that we do see that everywhere on the globe on the same day. So that's an additional comment. Thanks very much.
Okay. Thank you for pointing out the problems. Okay.
More questions? We have a few more minutes, or you can speak to the speaker afterwards. If there are no more questions, I'd like to thank Kosuke for presenting this Bowie lecture. Thank you.
Thank you.